And you're back with Your Best Chance with Judge Nance, and this is our last and final segment of the night, and I hope you can tell that I'm on new equipment tonight. I hope I sound a lot better than I have in recent weeks. But as you know, the theme of my show focuses on the criminal justice arena and my passion for young people, seniors, vets, and working families. But by special request tonight, I've been asked to stray into the lane of broadcast journalism. And interestingly enough, I once dreamed of being a broadcast journalist. Although I love what I do in the law, I still find it to be an interesting profession. Actually, I may be dating myself, and one of my favorite movies is titled Network, which some of you may recall starring Peter Finch, whose character coined the phrase, quote, "I'm mad as hell, and I'm not going to take it anymore." Well, here tonight is a real live broadcast legend who decided to write a tell-all about the behind-the-scenes drama of broadcast journalism in our little town, and that is Mr. Mort Meisner. Welcome to the show, Mort.
Hi, Judge. Thanks so much for having me on. And you know, you enjoy such a great reputation. It's an honor to be on with you. Thank you so much.
Well, you're welcome. And just to remind all of you out there, and you know you've heard the name, Mort Meisner ran television newsrooms in Chicago, St. Louis, WXYZ, WJBK here in Detroit for the last 20 years. And he's been an agent that represents TV and radio talent throughout the United States. Mort is a native Detroiter and attended the University of Detroit, as did I, before it was Mercy. And welcome, Mr. Meisner, once again. What a pleasure to have you.
My honor. Thank you. Yeah, I was going to say, go ahead. Sorry.
Before we begin to talk about your book, tell us a little bit more about your background in history, and then we're going to go into Enough to Be Dangerous.
Yeah, well, I grew up in Detroit at Myers and Fenkel. And, you know, it's interesting because the book opens up with a race riot I was part of, and it was a real riot. In 1959, I was going to Guest School, Edgar Guest, and I grew up very poor, and we lived in an area. There was a lot of what was referred to as white trash in the area there, and they bussed in some black children. They used to refer to them as colored kids, you know, way back, and parents were there to greet the bus, and they greeted the bus with rocks and stones and N-words. And all I remember is being a little boy and they're crying and watching helplessly. And that's had a profound impact on my life. We escaped that area for another poor area, a real poor area of Oak Park growing up. Mm-hmm. You know, very, very challenging childhood, and then as an adult, what I call some self-inflicted gunshot wounds, dealing with cocaine in the early 80s when I was at ABC and CBS News. It was very prevalent. Happily, that's 30 years in the rearview mirror, but I had a great chance during my career to work with the likes of Bill Bonds and John Kelly. And, of course, I brought Huell Perkins to Detroit from St. Louis after bringing him to St. Louis from Baton Rouge. I did a lot of investigative producing and reporting. And, you know, the media is under fire now, and there's a lot of good reasons why it is. And, you know, one of the things,
first of all, why you decided to, after witnessing what you did as a child, is that what motivated you towards a career in broadcast journalism? What brought you into the industry?
Well, I had been a pretty major rock and roll promoter as a teenager and into my early 20s, but I always wanted to be in TV news. And I started as a peon, an entry level job at WXYZ way back, you know, in 1977. And I fell in love with it because I saw an opportunity to educate the public, affect change, make a difference in the lives of, you know, my fictitious viewers, George and Martha. But I also witnessed a lot of things I didn't like, you know, blacks and women and Hispanics being discriminated against very often behind closed doors by the, I jokingly refer to them, by the predominant fat, white, bald men who run the industry. And I say that, you know, as a metaphor, because it could be women, too. But the industry was and is predominantly run by Caucasians, and I'm hoping that changes over the years.
So what was the sexism and racism in the industry like? Can you give us some examples, what do you write about in the book?
There's a chapter called The Garbage Men, and this was how black men literally were referred to at one of the stations I worked at in Chicago, and it referred to when all the important stories were doled out to the white reporters. There was generally back then, I hate using the term, a token black man that worked in the newsroom, and they were generally low men on the totem pole. And they would say, well, give that story to the garbage man. He'll be able to handle it. And it was despicable and something I fought against through my career running newsroom and really still fight against it as an agent. To really bring that point home, there's a wonderful man from Detroit who worked for me at Channel 2, Al Allen, that many people would know. I think I inherited Al when I took over Channel 2, and I'll just say he had been treated with tremendous disrespect. And I had some great meetings with him, motivational meetings, and I was so proud of him because I saw his work get better, his confidence get better, and more pride in his work. And, you know, I'm proud to say Al Allen not only was a really a good reporter, but a great man, and I'm proud to call him a friend.
He was at the scene of a lot of important stories. Even though they may have been giving the stories to the garbage men, so to speak, he was at the scene of what turned out to be a lot of important stories. So that has a way of turning around, doesn't it?
Yeah, he was, and it does. And, you know, on the female front, I worked with a crotchety old man, white man in Chicago, and a crotchety boss who they felt women should be home raising children and making dinner.
And then you worked with Diana Lewis.
And I had the honor of representing her, and I do represent Glenda. I refer to Diana in my book as the greatest female anchor I ever worked with.
Wow.
Obviously, people may debate, you know, this and that. Carmen was great, but I didn't work with Carmen. But I would put Diana Lewis up against anyone, anywhere, ever. She was that good and always prepared and cared about not only the viewers, but she was a great team member and cared about her fellow workers as well.
Wow. And you also covered a lot of controversies during the Coleman Young era. Things were hot at that time, and even Devil's Night, as they used to call it, and I'm glad it's in the past, was hot at that time.
Yeah,
you covered those stories.
I did, and there's one story I tell in the book. Mayor Young, he would frequently call me to complain and moan about things, and one night he called me. It was a couple days before Devil's Night. And in his saltiest language, one demanded to know what was so sacrosanct about showing the fires from previous years, what was so sacrosanct about calling it Devil's Night. And I paused and I thought about it. And I said, Mayor Young, you're right. And I stopped calling it Devil's Night. And I stopped showing fires from previous years because all it did was fan the flames and inspire people to set more fires. I took a lot of heat in my newsroom because I felt I was kissing his butt, but I felt it was the right thing. And it was so controversial. I was interviewed by a number of national media outlets because I was being accused of being more like the Chamber of Commerce than a newsroom. But Mayor Young was right about that, and I'm glad I did that, and I never looked back.
And that started to really turn around the negative national image that we had in Detroit, and you were part of making that happen.
I was real proud of that, and I think, you know, I had my ups and downs with Mayor Young, but I think he was the right man for a long time as mayor. He may have stayed a little too long, but, you know, he was a great bare knuckles politician, and he did what he thought was right.
So you've got stories. You know where the bodies were buried, as they sometimes say. Do you have anything from the book that you can just read to us briefly tonight before we go off the air tonight to give?
I can tell. I actually don't have it in front of me, but there is an incredible story about how, you know, where the bodies are buried, so to speak. And this really has to do with viewers and the community. There's an amazing story. You know, at one point in the 80s, the Detroit Police Department was, majority of it was white. And black-on-black crime, or even white-on-black crime, was largely ignored. And a story that still haunts me today that I talk about in the book had to do with a black woman by the name of Portia Black called me. Her son, she claimed, had been kidnapped. I called the cops. They said it was probably a domestic, and I didn't, as if that isn't important. And of course it is.
And that's what we referred to earlier tonight on a theme on domestic violence, how domestic violence wasn't important to the policing officials at one time.
No, so much so, when we would call police departments to find out if there was any crime, they would say, no, just a domestic, a guy killed his wife, you know. But going back to this, the bottom line is, because the cops back then were lazy, they didn't look for the child, and it turned out that child, a little boy, was raped and murdered by the next door neighbor and shoved in his attic. And that story still haunts me, because I always wonder of, could I have done more? You know, working with the likes of Bill Bonds, Diana, Huell Perkins, these were amazing people. And if I have 60 seconds, I'd love to leave the audience with an amazing story about Huell Perkins.
Please do.
Huell, one of the finest men I've ever met, in or out of the business, was giving a speech to a group of young boys and girls, predominantly black, about 15 years old, at Channel 2. And Huell, at the end of the presentation, a young man raised his hand, said, "Mr. Perkins, can I have your autograph?" And Huell pointed his finger, looked at him sternly, and said, "No, I will not sign any autographs." And then he said, "Today. But if each of you write me a letter, I will set asking for an autograph, I'll send each of you a letter back." And he made that into a lesson on the importance of writing and reading. And there was not a dry eye in there, including me. And so we're fortunate to have people like Huell and Devin Skillian and Diana in our city. And I hope people read the book. You know, it shows I was able to overcome some personal challenges, but I really feel like I've left a good mark in an industry that I still participate in.
How did you come up with the title, Enough to Be Dangerous?
I'm going to tell you. My son came up with the title because he said, "Dad, you were dangerous to yourself. You courted danger," because I did a lot of undercover investigations, a couple of which I was almost murdered. a lot of the stories I did caused me to live dangerously. It initially was going to be called something else, but I believe so much in the title, I tattooed it to my left pectoral muscle.
Oh, my. Geraldo Rivera used to be a favorite of many people because of investigative reporting. So investigative reporting then became a part of almost every news station, and it's one of the segments that a lot of people look forward to. You said you almost died in an investigative reportive capacity while on the job.
Yeah, I had done an investigation into a guy that he was running boiler rooms where they scam people out of money on the phone. Wound up having him put in prison, but one night he sent someone to shoot me in Chicago, and they were taken off the fire escape where I live in the Gold Coast of Chicago. I once infiltrated a child pornography ring that was run by motorcycle gangs, and if not for the cops coming in when they did, I probably would have been killed then. But I live less dangerously now, fortunately.
All right. I mentioned at the top of your segment that I, too, once dreamed of being a broadcast journalist. What would you say to those young people listening who, of course, you want to encourage to write your book before they venture out? But is it still a good industry? Is it a great place to work? Is it exciting and interesting and everything we all think it is?
Yeah, it is. You got to go to school, though. And nothing against Bex Howard. That's a more of a technical school. You need to go to a school with a good journalism program. You need to write, read, and you need technical skills. So if any parents have young boys and girls that are interested and they want to stay in the state of Michigan, Michigan State and Central are great. And I know I'm probably going to regret it, but this is who I am. I like giving back. Anyone that may have questions about the industry, they can email me, mort@mortmeisner.com. I return every email and every call, and I'd be honored to give advice to any parents or young men and women about that. But it is a great industry. You know, people get paid obscenely now, just not obnoxiously. The money isn't what it used to be. You know, Bill and Diana were seven-figure people, and they deserve to be. Those salaries have pretty much gone away.
Okay. And are you doing any book readings anyplace locally that you can invite people out to? Where are you going to be? Where are you selling the book? How can people obtain Enough to Be Dangerous?
So the book, which we're really proud of, is a bestseller on Amazon.com in several categories. Also, BarnesandNoble.com, available at the Book Beat in Oak Park, Paper Trail, in Royal Oak. Right now, everything else is virtual, but, you know, we're talking to the city of Detroit about doing a fundraiser. I love the city, and I like giving back, so I'm excited about that as well. And we'll be doing some things in person as this virus subsides.
All right. And I want to give a quick shout-out, if I may, to your publishers, two sisters writing and publishing. And I only want to do that because they are the daughters of my colleague, retired Judge Marilyn Atkins, who's been on the show with her book. And again, it was writing and publishing by two sisters. Was it a fun process for you?
It was. And Elizabeth Atkins, who was one of those sisters, I hired as a writer at Channel 2 when she came out of college. They're wonderful people, and they've done a great job, and it's such an honor and a privilege to work with them.
What a small world. So once again, there was a press release on October 12th of this year saying the book was available. Has the pandemic held you back at all in promoting this book, or
no,
still marching right ahead?
Yeah, and you know, I'm scheduled to be on Good Morning America coming up soon, CNN. No, it hasn't held me back. You know, just I really collaborated with Elizabeth and her sister, and it's been a real labor of love, and it's been an opportunity for me to leave a legacy and also, you know, talk about my cocaine challenges I had, my business successes, and I'm very prideful about my two sons and daughter and grandkids.
Why did you feel it was important to talk about your cocaine challenge? You've mentioned that a couple of times.
Yeah, because if I could quit using, well, you know, I did it for 8 years. I did it when I was a rock and roll promoter, and after that, I just felt people need to know there's hope. I mean, cocaine, John Lennon said this of the Beatles, it's the one drug that no matter how much you do, you want more. And, you know, I tried quitting with willpower. Well, the next time you have a good case of diarrhea, try using willpower to keep from going to the bathroom. It doesn't work. You need help. You need guidance. You might need treatment. And I just share with people, if I could quit using cocaine, anyone can. And the other part of it is my son, who's 27. You know, I was told at one time, the one thing you should do is lie about drug use. And I lied about it to my kids, and I regret it. And I found out my son knew. And, you know, I came clean. I had a little family discussion, and then it freed me up to really talk candidly about it in the book.
Well, that's great. I know there was a story out recently about Smokey Robinson telling everyone about his cocaine struggles back during that same era. And you've probably met a lot of, especially in your business, a lot of celebrities as well. And unfortunately, it's behind you. But once again, this is Enough to Be Dangerous.
Yeah.
Mort Meisner is out now. Once again, how can people get in touch with you? You made an offer to answer every email.
Yeah, mort@mortmeisner.com. mort@mortmeisner.com. And that would just be my honor. And I do answer every email.
Well, thank you again for coming on tonight, Mr. Meisner. It's been very nice meeting you. I've never met you personally. I hope to one day.
I would love to.
I'd certainly like to get my hands on a copy of this book, so I intend to be out there. Again, the book is Enough to Be Dangerous, Mort Meisner, born and bred in Detroit. Let's see what he has to say. Let's find out what's going on behind the scenes.
Thank you.
Email me,
and I'll send you a book.
I'm going to do that.
All right.
Follow up. Have a great
Thanks,
night.
Thanks, Judge. Keep doing the
you're
great
welcome.
Job you're doing. Thank you, Judge.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Meisner. And I want to give a thanks to everyone who participated tonight, and thank you for listening to the show. As I said at the top of the show, we're now celebrating almost 2 years on the air. Thank you for tuning in to Your Best Chance with Judge Nance to better understand the criminal justice system, the courts, and those of us who serve there. Have a great weekend. Stay safe. Stay well. Find you.